Come on. Entschuldigung. Sie noch.
Good evening. We would like to welcome you to this event on behalf of the organizers, Gesellschaft für Plurale Ökonomik, Kreisky Forum, VW Zentrum, and the Institute for New Economic Thinking's Young Scholars Initiative, as well as the Economic Department of the Vienna University for Economics and Business. In particular, I would like to welcome Ms. Hannah B. Egger, director of the university. We're very glad that you're here.
Good evening.
My name is Katharina Writtekapper, and this is Steffen Bettin. We're both founding members of the Society for Pluralism in Economics, the Gesellschaft für Plurale Ökonomik.
This is the most recent in a series of events we hosted at to highlight research of heterodox economics. And we do this to promote scientific diverse discourse. Previous guests included Yanis Varoufakis and Lars Zül. We are the Society for Pluralism in Economics. The financial and ecological crisis became kind of obvious that the economics profession does not provide meaningful guidance to enable solving the 21st century's problems. We, as students, teachers and practitioners of economics from around the world, and in Austria, Vienna, Graz, Innsbruck, Linz. We believe that this does not stem from simply ignoring these topics. They do get a lot of attention in economics, but from the much too narrow approach in dealing with these. It is not sufficient to solve these. So, innovative, cross-disciplinary approaches who are concerned with the real-world problems are not taken... I just sorted my cards. They're not getting accounted for and they're not taken seriously in scientific debates. So, we think society, and rightful so, is paying less and less attention to the narrow-nistas of economics. What is pluralism? Pluralism, for us, is not describing an end, but a process. We understand pluralism as a mode of open scientific debate as a complement to an open society. Our guest, Professor Mazzucato, is a testimony that this works and that society wants to engage with these ideas.
We're amazed by the great interest in this event and our cause. And on behalf of the organizers, I want to thank you that you have taken the time to come here. And you have to be really interested in the topic because you're spending your Friday evening in the lecture hall. I also want to welcome the people that are in the streaming room next door and also people who are streaming this event from wherever they are in the world right now. And turning to our guests that will later appear on the podium, I want to, in reverse order of appearance at the stage, I want to very much welcome our Chancellor, Christian Kern. And the reason why we talk about innovation and inclusive growth today is Professor Mariana Mazzucato, a professor who has written a spectacular book about the essential role of the state in large innovation processes. Let's please all welcome Mariana Mazzucato.
Der Altsinger. Der Altsinger. Ah, jetzt gleich.
Wieso? Sorry.
Okay. We're not hosting this event alone, and we are, besides the other organizations, especially and very thankful to you to allow us to be in this magnificent space. And we would like to welcome now Professor Wilfried Alzinger, head of the Research Institute Economics of Inequality. We consider it as a testimony to our cause that the economics department has chosen to support tonight's event. Professor Alzinger.
Thank you very much. Dear ladies and gentlemen, dear Mariana, dear Rector, dear Chancellor Kern. On behalf of the University of Economics and Business and on behalf of the Department of Economics, I'm delighted to welcome you at our university. The number of attendees here in the room shows us convincingly that there is a great demand for such discussions. If I had to characterize today's event, I would emphasize 2 points. First, it is an open discourse between an economist and a politician, although their views, their purposes, their aims, yet also their languages are very different. It does not happen every day that politicians and economists talk and listen to each other in an open-minded manner. If we look at today's real world and its main social and economic problems, such as growing unemployment, increasing income and wealth disparities, the ecological misfortunes, and finally the probably approaching breakdown of the international economic community, which has started with the Brexit votum, it is more urgent than ever before that economists and politicians, as well as experts from other fields, share an open discourse and develop solutions by interdisciplinary cooperations. The second feature, which I think is necessary to mention today, is the type of economist which Mariana Mazzucato stands for. She is not only a distinguished economist within the scientific community, she is in particular well known as a resolute advocate of pluralism and interdisciplinarity. Certainly, in particular, this special feature makes a discussion of experts from different angles more rewarding. Since one of the central missions of our university is, let me quote, to participate in public discourse with society and exchanging knowledge with all relevant stakeholders, I think an event like this fits perfectly well into the general tasks of our university. In this respect, we, the University of Economics and the Department of Economics, are proud to provide the opportunity for such an exchange of ideas. I want to thank in particular the young students' organization Plurale Economie for organizing this great event. Let us hope that occasions like this will follow. I wish all of us an interesting and exciting event. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Alzinger, for these nice introductory words.
So we're getting close to the talk of Mariana Mazzucato. Let me now introduce her. She's the R.M. Phillips Professor in the Economics of Innovation at the Science Policy Research Institute, University of Sussex, and author of The Entrepreneurial State, Debunking Public versus Public Sector Myths, in German, Das Kapital des Staates. She has held academic positions at the University of Denver, the London Business School, Bocconi University, and the Open University. She advises policymakers around the world on innovation-led growth and is winner of the 2015 Hans Mathöfer Prize, awarded by the Friedrich Ebert Stiftung, and the 2014 New Statesman Sheffield Political Economy Research Institute Prize in Political Economy is also hers. In 2013, she was named as one of the 3 most important thinkers about innovation in the New Republic. Her latest co-edited book, which you can, by the way, buy here at our It's a bookstore selling them. But yeah, Rethinking Capitalism, Economics and Policy for Sustainable and Inclusive Growth. That's the title of the most recent book. So without further ado, I would like to ask Professor Mariana Mazzucato to the stage.
So thank you so much, Caterina, Stefan, and Professor Atzinger. It's a real honor to be here. And especially thank you to your chancellor, who tweets so much. I'm not sure when he's working, but just kidding.
Ich habe meinen Teil vergessen, wo ich die Sache erkläre.
No. That was not a critique. We have to begin on a positive note. I must say, I was very inspired when I first heard about how Chancellor Kern was using the iPhone example, because as you will hear in a minute, and I will do the usual theatrical thing about the iPhone, for me it's not enough to talk about innovation. In fact, to be honest, I'm increasingly becoming bored talking just about innovation. It's really what it means. I don't know why I'm already moving my slides. What it means for our ability in the, let's just call ourselves progressives, I hope so, right? We are all progressives in this room. We even have nice red chairs. To have a new theory of where wealth comes from. And if we really take that seriously, to really understand the role of the public sector in actively being a creator or co-creator with the business community, with the third sector, with civil society, in creating value and wealth, and really to change the way we talk about the wealth creators, then I think really the progressive agenda will start to actually have a very strong story to be telling out there, and to perhaps limit this rise of, if you want, populism, where such simple narratives and very simple stories are being told to attract those people who have, you know, really do feel left behind for very good reasons, because many people have been left behind across the world. But we're not going to achieve that just by using the usual, if you want, social democratic discourse that just talks about distribution, redistribution, and how important our values are, as important as they are. We also really have to tackle some of the pillars of the way that that the other side, if you want, has talked about wealth creation. And that, in some ways, is my goal tonight. And to link also in a very concrete way how we can talk about the big objectives today, which is not just smart innovation-led growth, which is a great new word, which really reflects the fact that we don't want consumption and personal debt-driven growth, but investment and innovation-driven growth, but to also combine that objective and not see it as a trade-off with inclusive growth. And this really is something that I feel that your chancellor, more than many other politicians out there, really not only understands, but has been advocating. And even though we first, if you want, got to know each other on Twitter, I am very interested, and I hope that this is really just the aperitivo to a much longer conversation that we have, perhaps also with our teams of researchers, as well as the pluralistic economics groups of people who are thinking actually about innovation as well as inequality, and how appropriate actually that your Institute of Inequality is hosting this. Anyway, so I will speak no more than, I have, 27 minutes left, and I will probably jump through some of the slides. I've really just put them here to support some of the things I'm saying, but I don't want this to be mechanistic, given that you said it's in conversation with, and yet the chancellor is sitting there as a student, and I don't like that. Ideally, we would have been here talking to each other, but hey, you're going to have to be a student for 20 minutes. Okay? And because I actually want to, you know, sort of at least in the beginning, you know, do things a bit carefully, which is I really think that we have a discursive problem. Yeah, as I just said, we have a big problem in how we narrate, how we describe, how we tell the stories about wealth creation, and this, you know, really important role that public policy has always actually had has faced an obstacle, especially, not only, in the economics tradition. Because in economics, of course, we talk about the role of the state. I mean, we have both macroeconomic policies, monetary policies, trade policies. You know, it's not that we avoid the state, but the language through which we talk about public sector activity, I think, is quite lame. It's quite boring. And it then affects what policymakers think they can do. I've learned recently there's a term called performativity in philosophy to actually address this, which is that how we talk about things then affects the activities of those, for example, actors, which then affects how we judge their performance, which then reaffects how we talk about them. Yeah, so actually changing how we talk about things matters. Don't forget that Plato said storytellers rule the world. So let's start changing the story. And we have to begin, I think, with changing the words. So this notion that somehow, at best, what the policy process is about is fixing problems, fixing market failures, as economists talk about, or leveling the playing field, or in the world of innovation, de-risking through different types of instruments, the private sector, that really kind of misses this much more active, interesting wealth creation process, which is what I want to be talking about, and which I hope will arm you, literally, with armory in the battle, because there is a battle, there's a war out there, all sorts of wars, war on poverty, war against inequality. We need better words to talk about it. So instead of just talking about system failures, we need something else. But, you know, all of you who hopefully, some of you who hopefully in this room have studied economics, I don't have to lecture you too much, but just for the general population, what I mean by this notion that we're just fixing failures is this market failure framework in economics, which even in the world of innovation would say when you have, you know, something like a public good, like basic research, the government has to come in and fix that problem by investing in basic science. There's no real controversy on this, yeah? The real controversy starts coming when you start looking at the huge breadth and depth of actual public investments, which have been much more about creating and shaping markets, not just fixing them. This framework is useful and should continue to be used by policymakers. When you have negative externalities like pollution, you need things like carbon taxes, absolutely. But getting out of this image of, again, the policymaker just coming in to put bandages is a huge, huge challenge. It's especially a challenge given that we're constantly fed that, you know, in fact, what we should be doing in the policymaking arena is just kind of fixing the background conditions, spend some money on infrastructure, spend some money on education and skills, but then, hey, get the hell out of the way so the real revolutionary wealth creators can do their thing, right? So the economist kind of, you know, tells us this story all the time. And the image that you have these revolutionary, right? The word revolutionary was there by the economist, these revolutionary guys on the right, the Zuckerbergs and all the entrepreneurs and the startups, these really cool, you know, actors in the economy, and then the boring bureaucrats, right? Kafka's a bureaucrat here. This image affects where people want to work. I mean, if you were fed this, and we are fed this literally every week, not only by The Economist, but this constant, dichotomy of the boring bureaucrat. I was just at the Drucker Forum, great forum, but I cannot tell you how many times I heard about the bureaucrats. They're getting in our way, right? You know, we need to lighten things up and allow bottom-up experimentation. So bottom-up versus top-down, right? This heavy weight of policy. This is constantly fed to us. This doesn't mean this doesn't exist. I am from Italy, and I am not naive. I know how bad bureaucracy can become. Of course, there's all sorts of impediments, and of course, we do have to lighten up all sorts of processes within the policymaking process. But this narrative, again, of the wealth creators on one side, and on the other side, at best, the cheerleaders, leveling the playing field, fixing basic conditions, is, I think, profoundly wrong. It's profoundly wrong historically, because historically where interesting things have happened, when and where they have happened, you have actually required revolutionary types of policymaking, thinking out of the box. Remember Steve Jobs' great quote to the Stanford graduating class when he said you have to be hungry and foolish, and you know, in order to innovate, in order to be a real game changer. Well, the same thing of policymakers. You must be hungry and foolish, but by constantly feeding us this image, it's very hard even to welcome that hungry and foolish process in the policymaking arena. And so we end up having this self-fulfilling prophecy. We describe it this way. So again, the performativity thing that I said before. So it ends up becoming this way. And it does affect who wants to go into government. And luckily, you have a young, good-looking chancellor who decided to go into government anyway. But I can tell you that many people, unfortunately, are no longer making the choices that they might have been making before this, if you want, backlash that I would date from the 1970s onwards. in the policymaking arena. Now, I always cite Polanyi because I think his work was revolutionary, and I would really welcome every policymaker to read his book. Who was it? The mayor of Reykjavik told his whole policymaking group to see The Wire. Right, film, I would say everyone has to read this book. Why? Because it completely changes how we think about the market. The market is an outcome. The market is an outcome of the interactions between different types of actors. And so you don't have the market and then policy here intervening in the market. The policymaking process itself is part of that market shaping and market creating process. And so I've kind of become a missionary in this attempt to really enable economists, because economists are always advising policymakers. You know, Keynes's famous quote of, you know, all the practical guys on the floor and women in the policymaking arena, they think they're just getting their hands dirty and they're not bounded by all these theories, but actually they are slaves of defunct economic theory, Keynes said. What I'm trying to do is, if you want, unshackle some policymakers so they really get this kind of market shaping, market creating process, which Polanyi told us about historically. He looked at the evolution of capitalism and really found this very strong market shaping process through policy. But also Keynes, who I think has been misunderstood, by the way, by many Keynesians, who at best see the role of public policy as just, again, intervening in moments of recessions where we need counter-cyclical spending, which unfortunately in Europe we have not done, and we've created a big mess. So it is an important point, counter-cyclicality, but that's not enough. In this great quote by Keynes, he's saying, do something big. Right? And there's no reason that the doing something big and not just tinkering on the edges should just be limited to periods in which things are bad. In fact, almost all the investments that I will be sharing with you, talking to you about, important investments that have been made by public institutions, most of them actually happen in boom periods. This is not just about getting out of a crisis. Having said that, given the economic crisis, which we continue to live in across many parts of the world, this story is even more important. But it's very important to get out of this notion, which is also a market failure, right? Coordination failure, that during a recession, we need that public sector activity. What do you do in the boom? Do you just step back? No. As we know, innovation and growth have not only a rate, they have a direction. And that directionality of economic growth is just as important in the boom as it is in the bust. So anyway, I wrote this book, which is being sold outside, sorry for the self-marketing, but your language translation, I think, is the best. Das Kapital des Staat, the capital of the state. So what I really want to be talking about is the role of the state potentially as lead investor, not only lender of last resort, again, also very important. In Europe, we kind of forgot about it for a bit too long after the crisis, and finally Draghi remembered. So not only lender of last resort, but even investor first resort. And what does this mean for literally thinking about portfolios? You know, investing, for example, if you have a green policy across a whole set of different types of not just technologies, but also different ways of thinking about organizational change, social change, but across different areas, also to keep our paths open, possibilities open, not putting all our eggs in one basket, but also in terms of socializing, not just the risks, but also the rewards, as any investor would. So I'm going to focus on these big four questions. I'm just going to read them out now, because I have a feeling that I'm going to have to rush through quite a bit at the end. But these are the four questions. This is sort of the takeaway that I hope Christian Kern gets, but also your team, and hopefully in how we can talk about this in the future, which is, I think these are the four big questions for governments around the world today, for policymakers in different arenas. The first is what I've just said, which is that growth doesn't just have a rate, it has a direction. And instead of worrying about this notion that government, shouldn't pick winners and it should, again, just be facilitating, let's admit this directionality and have an open debate, even with civil society, about that direction. Economies do have to decide how, in which direction they want to go, whether it's a green direction or in the 60s and 70s when big decisions were made around IT. This notion that, in fact, you should just be facilitating and then stepping back simply has no historical analogy. And so let's actually, face this directionality head on. The next thing is we actually have to be building public organizations across different domains that even welcome this explorative process of trial and error and error and error, which innovation entails, if we want to have innovation-led growth. If we don't want innovation-led growth, then you know that's not so much of a problem. We can do the Irish thing, which is just lower your tax and hope that capital comes in for a bit and then leaves again. But if we want serious innovation-led growth, we actually also need public organizations that are going to welcome that explorative and internal capacity-building exercise in order to become learning organizations. And what I actually see around the world is the opposite. There's this incredible trend of outsourcing instead of investing in-house in different types of public organizations to increase their learning capacity. Third, if we are going to have market shaping and market creating, and not just this lame, boring market fixing, well, we better have metrics that capture that. Otherwise, otherwise what often happens is even when you have these kinds of public investments, then when they get evaluated, they get evaluated in very static and linear ways with tools that are actually coming pretty much from cost-benefit analysis done quite linearly, but also in terms of this market failure approach. So it's not enough to invest and to have an interesting approach to public policy. That must translate into better ways to assess those policies that capture the dynamism of that market-shaping, market-creating process. And lastly, and this is something that I know Chancellor Kern really welcomes a lot in terms of opening up the conversation on this, this notion that you're just there to fix has also caused a problem, which is socialization of risks in reality through different public measures, but privatization of rewards. So as soon as we say we're not just de-risking, we're taking on risks together between different actors, which create an economy, which create a market, markets as outcomes, then admitting that process through which even the public sector is taking on pretty big risks, in fact, I would argue the biggest risks, especially early stage in the capital intensive areas characterized by high technological and market risk, then because those risks will sometimes lead to failures, how can we actually make sure that we have concrete ways to socialize both the risks and the rewards so that smart innovation-led growth becomes also inclusive growth? So these are sort of the four big questions, which I think at the level of particular departments are really kind of game-changing, but also at that more general level, it just changes the conversation. It's very much a conversation around opportunity creation and also better understanding what really drives private investment, which in the end is a very important problem for countries like Austria, but also the UK and Italy, where private investment remains quite low. By having perhaps a more mission-oriented, direction-setting policy and also ways to share the risk between public and private actors, we can also boost private investment. And this is what I will hopefully get across through some of these slides. So let me just quickly go through the first point, because I'm not sure how familiar some of you are with this important point about just how much public activity has done around the world. The first point is simply that if we want to talk about innovation, we better understand where the big innovations came from. And don't think just high tech. I mean, lots of the big innovations are also about diffusion and deployment of existing technologies. So demand pull activity, just as important as supply push. But even just looking at these very famous general purpose technologies, the first thing we learn is that the, again, breadth and depth of public intervention was actually across the whole innovation chain. Not just the classic market failure where, again, basic research and science has to be spent on by public actors, right? So not just basic research, but also lots of applied research and even early stage financing for companies themselves, and then also demand pull policies, which we shouldn't forget, again, are extremely important. So mass production, that big revolution that occurred 100 years ago, would not have had the effect it did across the whole economy in changing production and distribution and even consumption without demand-side policies, for example, those related to suburbanization. People didn't just wake up and want to go live in the suburbs. And Carlota Perez and I have written quite a bit about this, how green today could actually potentially become a new direction on the demand pull side as well for the IT revolution to get fully deployed and fully diffused. So green, not just as renewable energy innovation, which is important, but also as demand pull policies for existing ICT areas, which have not been fully deployed. But anyway, this huge, you know, broad and deep commitment of public activity is very hard to justify just with these kind of bandage market failure policies. Let me just skip ahead. So the iPhone example sometimes looks like it's all the military industrial complex, right? So what is this story? It basically says that, again, if you look at your iPhones, your smartphones, or any of your smart products, all the technology that actually makes it smart and not stupid was, in fact, publicly financed through different types of organizations. When people see this, they say, oh, yeah, whatever. You know, she's talking about the military-industrial complex, so we have to go to war to get these kind of things. And really what's interesting is that the lessons, you know, the lessons that have been learned across countries, and I would point there to countries like Israel, as problematic as it might be politically, but at least in terms of what it learned, the real story that it learned from the US, very much in terms of building these active public organizations across that whole chain. But the lessons that have been learned is that it's not just about military, it's also about energy, about health, okay? So DARPA, which was very important for the internet, now has a sister organization in the Department of Energy in the US called ARPA-E. But the real story here, I mean, the real problem to me is not about saying, was it the state, was it Apple? The first point is simply that all this technology in the iPhone was in fact publicly funded, the internet, GPS, touchscreen display, Siri. But the problem that I want to allude to is the first one, the issue about the narrative. When you have a whole book on Steve Jobs and Apple, almost 800 pages, where not one page, not one paragraph, not one sentence, not one word on any of these public investments that were important for entrepreneurs like Steve Jobs and Bill Gates and the Zuckerbergs and the Elon Musk to surf, that's the problem, right? And it also leads to very problematic innovation policy when people say, oh, you know, why don't we have Apples? Why don't we have Facebooks? Why don't we have Amazons? And then they think the problem is just, you know, we need more entrepreneurs, we need more venture capitalists, without admitting this huge wave of financing which these entrepreneurs were able to surf. Again, health spending, very important in the US. It's the second most important spender on innovation after defense. Green, extremely important. So if you look at all the clean tech investments in the world, we can do that with this great database by Bloomberg, Bloomberg New Energy Finance. Most of the high capital intensive, high technological and market risk investments are coming from different types of public actors. For example, public banks, KfW, China Development Bank, BNDES in Brazil, European Investment Bank, just those four public banks are the lead financers, actually, in terms of asset finance in the climate landscape. Now, I don't have much time to talk about this, but that's just sort of a fact. What's interesting, when you look at the amount of money that is going into green today, backing particular companies, because don't forget, when I said that those investments are downstream, this is extremely important, you know, financing actual companies. Why? What innovative companies need is not just any kind of finance, but patient, long-term, committed finance. Now, some countries, like Germany, will organize this through a public bank, you know, the KfW. Other countries, like Israel that I mentioned already, might do it through YASMA, the Public Venture Capital Fund. The US has done it very much through programs like the Small Business Innovation Research Program, which is through procurement, and they fund these small companies which are willing to engage. But the point is, when you look at this amount of money, it looks extraordinary, right? This one bank giving all this money to these green companies, but we shouldn't forget that someone like Elon Musk actually got $5 billion from the US government, very similar number to the ones you're seeing here, just for his three companies, Tesla, SolarCity, and SpaceX. So, you know, how countries have supported innovative firms might differ, but the fact that patient long-term finance is coming mainly from the public sector, not from the private sector, is just something that we should admit and then start asking ourselves, what can we learn from the organizational experiences of these particular pots of money, because it has not always worked out. I already mentioned that. Now, let me get to this organizational point, which I was mentioning, which I just did, which is let's learn from the actual organizations. Now, the first thing we see when we actually look at the DARPAs, you know, for the internet, the ARPA-Es, which came out with a very recent innovation in battery storage, is, or the KFWs of this world, is they don't describe themselves as fixing markets. They're very mission-oriented. Just look at these mission statements. And this comes back to the point I was mentioning in the beginning in terms of this self-fulfilling prophecy. If an organization describes itself, oh, I'm just there to tinker and to increase, you know, business investment by facilitating the wealth creators, what kind of people are going to want to work in those? If instead you have, for example, an ARPA-E, which was actually given the remit by Obama after the 2008 crisis in 2009 when they had their $800 billion stimulus for the economy, and Obama at least initially wanted to direct it around green, he managed to convince Steve Chu, a Nobel Prize winning physicist, to direct the Department of Energy in that sort of big enterprise, and they set up ARPA-E, an actual organization. And so this organizational dimension to public activity and how by giving a mission to particular organizations you're able to attract, you know, stars like a Nobel Prize winning physicist is a really important point. We should ask ourselves in Europe how much of this, you know, notion that, you know, we just have a bunch of bureaucratic, you know, civil servants in government is also related to, in some countries, like where I live, the UK, to our attitude towards government. So David Cameron famously said, civil servants are the enemies of enterprise. Now these civil servants who he's just, you know, bashed or have to deal with Brexit. So he's probably regretting having not treated them too well. But still, this, you know, importance of also increasing the vision and mission of organizations also to attract talent, but also then to enable them to take on risk, to explore, to build learning organizations, I personally think is an extremely important challenge that governments around the world have. I'm not going to talk about Germany. Sorry, let's move on. So assessment. Well, the point about Germany, to be honest, because I can't, you know, I'm from Italy, so I'm allowed to use this terrible word, the pigs. Portugal, Italy, Greece, and Spain, you know, they were told that they had actually been spending too much, when actually what we know is they have all been spending way too little in all these different areas that increase productivity. Italy's deficit has been lower than Germany's for two decades, lower than Germany's for two decades, but they have not been spending in those areas that Germany has been spending on, also across the whole innovation chain. What's the result? Two decades of zero growth in productivity, two decades and almost zero growth in GDP. So it's a ratio, debt to GDP. If your debt is rising at 2 or 4% annually, but your growth is not rising at all, in theory, that ratio can even go to infinity. Surprise, surprise. So, you know, actually really understanding what led to the competitiveness of the core countries and how the periphery, actually much of its problems was precisely at this organizational level, not having a network of different mission-oriented public actors, and not investing enough directly, too much indirectly through subsidies, creating potentially parasitic relationships between public and private is a very, again, important thing, I think, for the Eurozone to ask itself. Assessment. What does it actually mean to capture this active market creation process? Well, the first thing is to admit that many of the investments that I've been talking about were actually direct, not indirect. These were not done through incentivizing business to go and invest, but actually having the guts to think about, you know, how to steer a country, whether it's through a green strategy, an ICT strategy. I know that you have plans here for a new digital agenda strategy. What does it mean to actually create a new space, which then excites business? Because in fact, we see that many countries that have higher business spending in R&D are also those countries that were willing to, if you want, you know, take those risks to actually invest public money in something that did not exist already, which then excites business, which wants to, it creates animal spirits. It creates the expectations about where the future growth opportunities are. I don't have time to read this, but Keynes, you know, talked about animal spirits, but then he also said, we don't really have lions, tigers, and wolves. We've got a bunch of domesticated animals. And, you know, this creates a very different challenge, he said to Roosevelt. How can we actually create policy that makes our businesses want to roar rather than pretending that we're just sort of releasing them of different types of impediments? So his whole point in animal spirits was that just by reducing tax or just by reducing interest rates, that won't necessarily increase investment. unless you actually have the business community seeing new opportunities. And in fact, very much part of what I've been talking about is that these opportunities have been historically very much co-created by governments which were willing to take those risks in new areas. But you know, capturing this process of creating something new, whether it's the BBC in the UK, which through its investments redefined broadcasting, whether it's through pharmaceutical companies that instead, agencies within a government, drug discovery programs or life sciences programs, which try to redefine the market away just from drugs, but even to use, say, new concepts of lifestyle, and again, demand pull strategies, and being able to capture that new definition of what the market is. Unless we have dynamic metrics and indicators, we have a very hard time, because sometimes these organizations then are told that they are crowding out the business sector. So if anyone's interested in this, just look at what's happened to the BBC in the last year with its charter review and how it was accused of crowding out private broadcasters. And you look at the analysis, and there was very little ability of the evaluators to capture what a dynamic agency like the BBC had actually done, which was to transform fundamentally its landscape as opposed to just putting bandages here and there. Lastly, and I have, so I'll do this in 1 minute, this whole issue of socializing, not just risks and rewards, to me is such an important part of this whole story. Because in fact, if we, you know, look at some of the data that Piketty, in his absolutely fantastic book, he must be your next invitee, on inequality, and, you know, what's quite astounding is he talked to us in the book about things like capital gains taxes having fallen too much in many parts of the world and the effect that that had on increasing short-termism and inequality. But why that happened is fascinating. There's often been narratives and stories about innovation, about dynamism, about wealth creation that have been used to lobby for these potentially regressive policies in taxation. And in fact, it was actually the National Venture Capital Association that in the US lobbied for a capital gains tax to fall by 50% in just 5 years. And you need a communist like Warren Buffett to say, hello, I don't even look at capital gains tax. I look at opportunities, and that's when I invest. And in fact, lots of the experience I have with looking at innovation policies, many of these R&D tax credits, when they're focused on the profits that are generated from R&D, there's very little additionality. That's not what actually drives R&D spending. R&D spending in different, both small, medium, and large enterprises is often related to the expectations of these companies of where these future opportunities are, not just playing with their taxes. Lastly, this notion that Keynes, and I keep bringing up Keynes, this is now the third quote I put up, that we need to not just invest, but also think of new forms of investment, that the actual concrete way that a government invests is just as important as the total amount. He had this concept of socialization of investment, which I think has been underexplored by the Keynesians as well. And this really does bring us to, again, my last slide here, which is how can we think of different mechanisms through which the rewards, the returns that are generated from public investments can also be socialized. This can be through really simple things like getting companies to reinvest their profits back into the real economy, back into innovation, back into big innovation. That's, by the way, where Bell Labs came from, very important R&D lab in a private company. It was forced into existence by government telling a monopoly, AT&T, to reinvest. It can happen through the price mechanism. Prices of those goods, which are publicly generated like drugs, could reflect that public contribution. It could even happen through equity, like, you know, Tesla was invested in by government, so was Solyndra. Solyndra was a failure. Why didn't they treat that like a portfolio? Retain some equity in Tesla to cover those Solyndra losses. We could have a golden share of the patents. Anyway, there's many different ways to do this. My main point is we don't even ask the question of how to socialize the returns unless we have had a framework through which we talk about the role of public investment as investment, not just spending. Investing, risk-taking, thinking about transforming an economy, not just tinkering on the edges, the big risks that that will entail, but how can we let all of society share in the rewards precisely so that we have less disaffection, which leads to the kind of very, very scary populism which we are experiencing across the world. Thank you.
Thank you, Mariana, for this impressive talk. And now we're ready to hear a comment by the Chancellor on that talk. And later on, we will start a discussion. Yeah. Actually, one more thing. We have a very innovative way of, a very innovative way under the heading of today's event that the audience has the possibility to pose questions. You can do this via Twitter using the hashtag MasuKern, which is written here. Yeah, if you don't have a Twitter account, don't be ashamed using your neighbor's Twitter account for this purpose. Yeah, please. Yeah, sorry.
Yeah, ladies and gentlemen, that was really quite impressive and inspiring. And just having some thoughts on that MasuKern hashtag, because that sounds a little bit like Brangelina. And after your joke wasn't invented by me, sorry, to be honest. But after your very kind compliments, I really appreciate. Nevertheless, I would like to respond to some initial ideas. First is that I would like to thank very much to our today's host for the organization of this event, because what I've learned in the last 6 months is that politics is always about prevailing ideas. And for me, it makes a lot of sense to discuss about alternative approaches to progressive politics, and Mariana has contributed a lot in this evening and her impressive and inspiring presentation. Another aspect I'd like to stress is, Mariana, sorry, but there's only one of us who is really obsessed by Twitter. And sorry to say, because I can't afford that these guys got the impression that the taxpayers' money on my salary is squandered. So I'm just following you, Mr. Stiglitz and Krugman. So really, really, really serious in some sports channels. But the reason why I believe that it's of great importance to discuss here today is that because of three major considerations. The first thing is coming from management. I'm very much used to do business and also to do politics on an evidence-based approach. So what was said just at the beginning, that not so often economists and politicians are listening to each other, I think it's a big mistake, and we have to learn, and we can learn a lot of economic analysis of Mariana and some others. Second aspect is that I believe that Europe is going 8 years through a lackluster economic development, and that our biggest challenge today is to regain growth again. And so what's absolutely sure is that we have seen that the concept of austerity is not working out, and what we need is a new approach and new ideas promoting this idea of growth and creating employment, which is our most important priority. So that aspect is, and that's a very important aspect too, and you just mentioned that also in your presentation, is that for common social democrats, we have invested a lot of passion and ideas in the idea how we can distribute welfare. But what I believe very strongly is that we also have to discuss, perhaps even more like in the past, how we can create welfare, which is a change of concept. I would like to come to something which is really weird, because I was supposed to talk in German tonight, because there is a live stream on Facebook, and there are so many visitors who are perhaps not able to listen to English language, so I might be unpolitely switched to German language now. Sorry for doing that, but I'm getting much more and very slowly used to the presentations of Mr. Jean-Claude Juncker in the European Council, because what he's doing is starts a sentence in German, goes on in English, and finishes it in French, which is a tremendous task for the translators to follow. Always having pale faces. So, ja, auch für die Damen und Herren zu Hause, die folgen vielleicht noch ein paar Überlegungen, warum ich glaube, dass dieser Abend heute so wichtig ist. Und wir sind ja in der Woche 1 nach Trump. Und ich erwähne das, weil ich glaube, dass das eine direkte Linie ist zwischen dem, was wir heute diskutieren und dem, was wir erlebt haben und gesehen haben, auch an Analysen in der letzten Woche nach dieser amerikanischen Präsidentschaftswahl. Und was ich meine ist, dass das exakte Stoff auch ist, wenn man so will, der die politische Entwicklung Trump verbindet mit einer politischen Entwicklung, die uns zum Brexit geführt hat, die uns zum Aufstieg des Rechtspopulismus in vielen europäischen Ländern geführt hat. Weil wenn wir versuchen, diesem Phänomen auf den Grund zu gehen, dann gibt es jetzt eine Reihe von Erklärungen. Aber ich glaube, ganz, ganz wesentlich ist, dass wir heute an der Kombination, an einer Kreuzung von zwei Entwicklungen stehen, die eine unglaubliche Beschleunigung und einen riesigen Veränderungsprozess in Wirtschaft, Gesellschaft und Politik mit sich bringen. Und was ich meine ist, dass wir natürlich erlebt haben, dass die Globalisierung ein Phänomen ist, das eine große Zahl an Menschen aus der Armut geführt hat, dass sie Wohlstand geschaffen hat. Das steht unzweifelhaft fest, wenn Sie etwa an die Entwicklung in Asien denken. Aber dass wir jetzt immer weiter und immer deutlicher erleben, dass diese Globalisierung auch dazu geführt hat, dass insbesondere in den Mittelschichten der entwickelten Staaten in Amerika, auch in Europa, hier viele das Gefühl bekommen haben, dass sie zurückgeblieben sind und nicht ihren gerechten Anteil an dieser Wohlstandsentwicklung erlebt haben und dass das eben nur auf einige wenige Schultern sich schlussendlich verteilt hat. Und wenn man so will, trifft das Ganze jetzt auf eine Entwicklung, die natürlich geprägt ist durch diese Wirtschaftskrise, die ich vorhin erwähnt habe, wo wir sagen müssen, dass wir hier immer noch keinen finalen Plan haben, wie wir das überwinden können. Die Probleme sind nicht vorbei, die Diskussionen in weiten Teilen Europas sind nicht vorbei. Kein Wunder, dass der zuständige Kommissar gestern den Vorschlag gemacht hat, Moskau wie Sie, dass die Staaten mehr Geld ausgeben sollen für Investments. Er hat von 0,5% gesprochen, was ein völlig ungeheuerlicher Vorgang ist, weil bislang war die Aufgabe der EU-Kommission immer dafür zu sorgen, dass die Etats und die Budgets gekürzt werden und die Maastricht-Ziele erreicht werden. Aber der hat mittlerweile das erste Mal eine offizielle Stimme aus der EU-Kommission gesagt, nein, wir müssen mehr investieren. Zeigt schon, dass in breiten Teilen Europas mittlerweile der Eindruck entsteht, dass wir so, wie wir getan haben, nicht leicht weiter tun können. Aber es gibt für mich noch ein drittes Phänomen und das ist, wenn man so will, das, was die Entwicklung so enorm zuspitzt, das ist der technologische Wandel. Und dieser technologische Wandel ist durch die Begriffe Robotics, Automatisierung und Digitalisierung geprägt und das führt dazu, dass wir erleben, dass wir erst einmal weite Teile insbesondere der Arbeiterschaft exponiert haben gegenüber einem Wettbewerb mit Ländern, wo es nun mal üblich ist, sich nicht an unsere Lohnstandards, Sozialstandards und Umweltstandards zu halten, also wenn man so will, durch asiatisches Billigarbeitangebot. Und was wir jetzt erleben, ist, dass das jetzt noch beschleunigt und fortgesetzt wird durch die Roboterisierung. Und in dieser Situation, wenn man sich die Daten und Fakten anschaut, muss man ganz klar sagen, dass wir erleben und wir haben erst in dieser Woche wieder interessante Studien dazu gesehen, dass die Medianeinkommen in weiten Teilen Europas gesunken sind, insbesondere für die Mittelklasse. Geht man dem nach, schaut, warum das passiert ist, sehen wir eine zunehmende Spaltung in unserer Gesellschaft zwischen denen, die reguläre Jobs haben, ordentliche Beschäftigungen haben, vielleicht im öffentlichen Teil, vielleicht im großen Unternehmen, und jenen, die nicht mehr so einfach in reguläre Beschäftigungsverhältnisse finden. Und wenn Sie sich die Zahlen in Österreich anschauen, wir haben allein in Österreich 1,4 Millionen Menschen, das ist ein Drittel der Erwerbstätigen, die heute in Teilzeitarbeit beschäftigt sind oder als Einzelpersonen unternehmen und viele von ihnen sind das eben nicht in selbstgewählter Form. Und das produziert einen Stimmungscocktail, der in den letzten Tagen ausreichend beschrieben ist, auf den Politik Antworten finden muss. Und das ist ja nicht nur eine Frage sozusagen linker und progressiver Politik, sondern was mich sehr beeindruckt hat, ich bin gewesen bei der UNO-Generalversammlung und habe dort die Abschiedsrede vor der Vollversammlung der Vereinten Nationen von Obama gehört. Und der Obama hat dort eine Rede gehalten, die war wirklich bemerkenswert, die gegipfelt hat in solchen Sätzen, dass er gemeint hat, es ist doch logisch, dass eine Wirtschaft nie stabil sein kann und eine Gesellschaft nie stabil sein kann, wo 1% so viel besitzt wie 99%. Das ist übrigens nachzulesen, ist wirklich eine eindrucksvolle Rede gewesen, aber für mich noch einen Tick beeindruckender ist dann gewesen, als wenige Wochen später die Theresa May am Parteitag in Birmingham, beim Inaugurationsparteitag, bei den britischen Tories, also irgendwie nicht bei der Linken oder bei den französischen Kommunisten, sondern bei den britischen Tories, Sätze gesagt hat zur britischen Business Community wie: Ich sage euch eines, wenn ihr weiter eure Arbeiter ausbeutet, um höhere Dividenden zu zahlen, dann bekommt es mit mir zu tun. Theresa May, die legitime Erbin Margaret Thatchers, die Führerin der britischen Tories. Und das kann man beliebig fortsetzen. Turnbull zum Beispiel, ehemaliger Goldman Sachs Partner und ein bekennender Konservativer, mittlerweile Premierminister in Australien, sagt, wir müssen den Kapitalismus zivilisieren. Also ich sage noch einmal, wenn der Erich Vogler das auf einem Gewerkschaftstag sagt, sagt jeder, okay, point taken. May, Turnbull, Obama. So, was da passiert ist, dass hier wirklich ein Umbruch stattfindet und was ich so ernsthaft glaube ist, dass man da sich wohl ein paar Dinge vor Augen halten muss, die man ernst nehmen muss und da Fakten und Stimmungen versuchen muss, sorgfältig auseinanderzuhalten, wiewohl Stimmungen natürlich in der Lage sind, Fakten zu produzieren. Und wir sind nun mal, und ich erlebe das immer wieder bei Diskussionen im öffentlichen Raum mit Leuten, die vielleicht nicht politisch engagiert sind oder nicht die Gelegenheit hatten, auf einer Universität zu studieren, wenn du mit denen diskutierst, wie sich Vermögen verteilt, wie sich Einkommen verteilt, wie ihre Lebensumstände sind, hörst du auch immer wieder, für die Banken habt ihr Geld gehabt. Und jetzt wissen wir, dass die Banken wichtige Institutionen sind und die brauchen wir für eine florierende Wirtschaft. Aber es ist der Eindruck entstanden, dass diejenigen, die die Auslöser für die Krise waren, nicht diejenigen sind, die jetzt die Zeche dafür zahlen. Dass in Wahrheit diejenigen, die heute ihre Arbeitsplätze verloren haben oder Einkommen verloren haben oder in prekäre Beschäftigungsverhältnisse gedrängt werden, die Rechnung zahlen für jene, die eigentlich nach einem kurzen sozusagen Welle der Unsicherheit eigentlich wieder ganz gut davon gekommen sind. Und diese Psychologie muss man ernst nehmen, weil ich bin ernsthaft nur überzeugt, dass worüber wir hier reden, ist in Wahrheit kein ökonomischer Diskurs, sondern ein Diskurs, der unsere gesamten Wertekonzeptionen in der Lage ist, in Frage zu stellen. Und das wird Sie vielleicht jetzt wundern, weil das etwas weit ausgeholt ist, aber meine Gedanken nach der Trump-Geschichte und wenn ich mir anschaue, wie der Aufstieg Le Pens funktioniert, der AfD funktioniert und Sie entschuldigen die Parteilichkeit, auch der FPÖ in Österreich funktioniert, dann ist es so, dass man heute feststellen muss, dass das, woran wir uns gewöhnt haben, was seit 60 Jahren das Fundament der europäischen Einigung gewesen ist, nämlich dass die Werte Demokratie, Rechtsstaat und der Respekt vor den Menschenrechten etwas ist, was keine Selbstverständlichkeit ist, sondern dass wir politisch sicherzustellen haben. Und ich bin davon überzeugt, wenn es uns nicht gelingt, die Wirtschaft wieder zu wachsen zu bringen, dann riskieren wir, dass die politischen Ränder zu wachsen beginnen und damit unsere Wirtschaft, aber vor allem auch unsere Gesellschaft potenziell zersetzt wird. Wie geht man also damit um? Und ich muss sagen, ich bin ein sorgfältiger Leser der Aufsätze und der Analysen von Frau Mazzucato gewesen und tue das auch heute noch. Und wir haben das ja heute auch in einer sehr eindrücklichen Form gehört, was sie empfiehlt. Und ich glaube, dass wir uns daran orientieren müssen, weil es uns die Perspektive gibt, sozusagen einen politischen Plan zu entwickeln, der wegkommt die Phänomene kommen, wir können eh nichts tun, hin zu einer Situation, wo wir sagen, ja, das ist unsere Welt. Wir wissen, dass wir die Globalisierung nicht zurückführen können, die Integration der Wirtschaften im globalen Maßstab macht viel Sinn. Und wir wissen aber auch, dass wir die Technologie nicht in eine Kiste sperren können und am Dachboden verscharren. Also brauchen wir einen aktiven Plan, wie wir aus diesen Möglichkeiten, die auf uns dazukommen, das Maximum herausholen. Und deshalb ist das so wichtig, dass wir uns da an einer Strategie orientieren und die versuchen wir auch in Österreich umzusetzen. Wir haben uns entschieden, bei der Budgeterstellung das erste Mal die öffentlichen Investitionen über 5 Milliarden Euro zu erhöhen. Das wird im Budget sein, das wird es demnächst beschließen. 800 Millionen Euro mehr als im Vorjahr. Das geht in Telekom-Infrastruktur, das geht in Bildungsinstitutionen, die Infrastruktur dafür, das geht in moderne Verkehrsnetze, Straßen und Bahnen. Wir versuchen auch die Kommunen zu unterstützen, um auf ihrer Ebene zu investieren, weil wir davon überzeugt sind, dass der öffentliche Sektor vorangehen muss, um hier letztendlich auch den Privaten zu stimulieren und schlussendlich sind das ja alles Aufträge, die vor allem auch an KMUs in den Regionen gehen. Wir haben zum Zweiten aber auch gesagt, wir versuchen natürlich die Stimmung zu verbessern, indem wir Investitionsanreize schaffen für private Unternehmen. Da gibt es einen ganz starken Fokus auf den Klein- und Mittelunternehmen. Das sind über 300.000 in Österreich, 1,8 Millionen Beschäftigte. Wir wollen versuchen, Investitionen hier zu stimulieren, auch um einen Beitrag zu leisten, die Stimmung zu verändern. Und wir haben uns entschieden, in dem Startup-Bereich ein Ökosystem zu kreieren, das uns dazu verleiten und helfen soll, dass wir Unternehmen, die einen gewissen Erfolg haben, nicht erleben, wie sie reihenweise aus Österreich ins Ausland gehen, um sich dort zu finanzieren und bessere Bedingungen vorzufinden, sondern dass wir vielleicht mal in die Lage kommen, dass Unternehmen, die aus dem Ausland nach Wien schauen, nach Österreich schauen, sagen, das ist ein guter Platz zu gründen, hier habe ich optimale Bedingungen. Das betrifft Incentives für Investoren, das betrifft Incentives für die Beschäftigten, das betrifft aber vor allem Garantien, Kredite und auch, und das ist auch ein bisschen eine Inspiration von Frau Mazzucato, dass wir uns entschieden haben, hier auch in Equity-Beteiligungen zu gehen, indem wir Instrumente aufsetzen, mit denen wir hier tatsächlich auch nicht nur das Risiko übernehmen als Staat, sondern auch die Möglichkeit haben, zu profitieren. Und ein solches Beispiel ist im Bereich der Quantencomputer. Sie kennen das vielleicht auf der Uni Innsbruck. Die Kollegen sind dort unglaublich avanciert. Die haben tolle, fantastische Forschungsprojekte umgesetzt mit öffentlichem Geld, mit ihrem Steuergeld. Jetzt kommt die nächste Phase, jetzt geht es in den Rollout und was wir jetzt dort versuchen werden, ist hier eine Plattform zu finden, wo private, die Forscherteams sich finden, wir das öffentlich finanzieren, in Equity gehen und damit die Möglichkeit schaffen, dass hier eine bahnbrechende Entwicklung aus Österreich kommt. Das ist das, was wir tun. Der dritte Sektor ist das, was klassisch ist. Das ist unser Fokus auf Bildung. Wir haben in dem Schulbereich, Sonja Hammerschmidt ist heute da, Bildungsministerin, einen großen Fokus. Das ist ganz klar. Wir wollen unsere Bildungssysteme modernisieren. Deshalb reden wir über Ganztagsschulen, deshalb reden wir über Schulautonomie. Ich will Sie da jetzt nicht anagitieren, aber warum das notwendig ist, ist, glaube ich, jeder, der jemals einen OECD-Bericht in der Hand hatte oder Benchmarks gesehen hat, der weiß, warum wir das zu tun haben und welche Fortschritte das bringen kann, was die Qualität unserer Ausbildung betrifft, hat auch sozialpolitische, frauenpolitische Komponenten. Aber wir beschränken das nicht nur auf die Schulen, sondern wir haben gesagt, bei den Fachhochschulen, wir versuchen das Angebot in den MINT-Fächern deutlich auszuweiten. Und was mir persönlich wichtig ist, wir haben ja eine immense Stärke in Österreich, das ist die Qualifikation unserer Facharbeiter. Da müssen wir konsequent daran weiterarbeiten. Und was wir jetzt schaffen, ist das erste Mal ein Stipendiensystem für Menschen, die eine Lehre gemacht haben, eine zweite Qualifikation zu erwerben und damit schlussendlich dann besser den Anforderungen zu genügen, die in den nächsten Jahren auf sie zukommen werden, weil wir wissen ja, dass eine Ausbildung am Beginn eines Berufslebens die Menschen nicht mehr sozusagen bis an ihr Karriereende tragen wird. So, und dann sind wir beim letzten Punkt, den ich noch machen darf, bevor wir dann zur Diskussion kommen. Eins finde ich schon interessant, was Frau Mazzucato gesagt hat über Warren Buffett, der ja auch ein paar sehr, sehr fortschrittliche, progressive Ideen immer wieder formuliert hat. Bei der Steuerfrage, ob das, würde ich das teilen, sozusagen, dass Steuer vielleicht jetzt nicht das primäre Begrünung für Investitionen sind, nur da glaube ich, hat sich unser Bild auch ein bisschen geändert, weil eines der ganz großen Themen, das wir in Europa mittlerweile haben, nach Panama Papers und dem ganzen Thema Tax Evasion, zu sehen, dass wir in Wahrheit in Europa hier auch ein Riesensolidaritätsproblem haben, nicht nur bei der grundsätzlichen Ausrichtung der Fiskal- und Wirtschaftspolitik, sondern auch bei der Steuerpolitik, weil es nun mal, ich glaube, kaum zumutbar ist, dass es in Wahrheit so ist, dass heute große internationale Restaurantketten weniger Steuern zahlen als jeder beliebige Würstelstand in Wien zum Beispiel und dass es für uns auch nicht akzeptabel ist zu sagen, okay, wir akzeptieren eine Entsolidarisierung in Europa, wo einige Länder Steuerschlupflöcher schaffen, durch die dann die großen Konzerne, Stichwort Apple, Irland, Sie kennen das, durchschlüpfen können und am Ende wir, die hier versuchen, einen Beitrag zu leisten, dass die Gemeinschaft wächst, dass Infrastruktur entsteht, durch die Finger schauen. Also da haben sich die Dinge auch ein bisschen geändert, aber das ist wahrscheinlich eines der weiteren ganz großen Felder, wo es auch europäische Initiativen gibt, die durchaus erfolgsversprechend ausschauen, an denen wir arbeiten. Vielleicht mal so viel zum Beginn. Okay.
Talk. The discussion is going to start soon. It will be structured in three blocks, let's say, whereas, let's say something about the topics that you raised, actually, because it seems like you don't want to talk about innovation too much, but I can tell you that my questions do raise this issue. Also, you were actually talking rather in a general manner, so I think we can very mm-hmm. well take a general to specific mm-hmm. approach here. And then, of course, my questions are guiding questions, and you can always focus on the messages that you want to transmit to the audience. The first two parts of the questions will be about growth and innovation and industrial policy. And then the third part will be about a topic that is very close to us, the Gesellschaft Plurale Ökonomik, about pluralism. I would like to start, first mm-hmm. of all, with Professor Mazzucato, with a rather, a general mm-hmm. question for the beginning, where you could also maybe include a replique on Chancellor Kern. Mm-hmm. You used the term inclusive growth a lot, and also we heard also in Chancellor Kern's talk that there are a lot of aspects besides growth as such, like unemployment, inequality. But please summarize for our audience what you mean by the concept and how it would be different to the growth that we're experiencing today.
Okay, so I have to make sure I look at you people too, otherwise I just look at them. So the question is, what do I mean by inclusive growth?
Yes, okay. Yeah, you talk about it a lot.
So I think it's the mirror image of the point that we were both making, which is we shouldn't talk about inclusion, inequality as just in terms of redistribution, but also in terms of who created the wealth in the first place. And so these last policies that I was mentioning at the end, they're not just about redistributing, you know, the profits once the profits are generated. It's about, hey, there is an immense amount of taxpayer risk that has also gone into, just as much as the venture capital risk, just as much as the, you know, entrepreneurial risk that goes into creating innovation-led growth. So let's have a bigger conversation on how to actually socialize both those risks and rewards. Obviously, that's not the only dimension of inclusive growth. One of the, you know, big discussions that people are having around the world today is about what's going to happen when the robots take our jobs. And these poor robots are just sitting there just saying, you know, program me. They're not interested in taking anyone's job. The real problem that we have in modern day capitalism is what's happening to profits. So we have an ultra financialized type of capitalism. We have record level hoarding. I don't know how you say hoarding in German in case anyone does it. Inert capital. So 2 trillion euros of inert capital being hoarded in Europe. $2 trillion, it's a very nice even match in the US. So, you know, that's the problem. David Ricardo, already in the 1800s, in the famous chapter 31 of his textbook on principles of political economy, was already talking about mechanization and the effect that it might have on jobs. Karl Marx talked about it. There's nothing new about today's mechanization in its modern form on its potential to take away jobs. There's always been that problem. But what we have today that we didn't have before was this process of creative destruction, not so much in terms of innovation, but literally profits being reinvested from today's types of sectors into tomorrow's types of sectors. So hoarding of cash and companies being financialized, and what do I mean by that? Using their profits to just buy back their own shares, to boost stock prices, stock options, and executive pay, that's the real threat to jobs.
Thank you.
And so inclusive growth is part of that, right? It means where is the negotiation, where is the deal, public-private deal, in terms of making sure that that reinvestment process occurs? We've given up.
Yeah, so that's the way you would tackle the problem that maybe not all parts of society are taking a share of economic growth.
Well, I mean, it's such a huge battle, one, that this would not solve everything. But I do think that we are being a bit irresponsible by, you know, just focusing on the bankers or the robots. You know, it's not about the size of finance. It's the fact that finance has been financing finance. That's called financialization of finance, but then there's also financialization of the real economy, where some of the biggest IT, pharmaceutical, and energy companies are not reinvesting their profits back into the economy. Those two aspects of modern-day capitalism, which has basically, I would date it from the 1970s onwards, is a big problem which has increased inequality, and the middle classes sort of having been hollowed out, and we've just seen it in the Trump election, is very much related to corporate governance issues, the shareholder value kind of a model, which, by the way, in Austria, you don't have much, do you? And so I think this could potentially, it doesn't mean that you're perfect, but I do think one way that Europe can rediscover itself, because currently we have no solidarity in Europe, and I think your point and also our conversation before, it's so important for Europe to rediscover its own narrative, not just the narrative for the progressives, but what is Europe about? Why not recreate a conversation in Europe about, you know, stakeholder capitalism as being something that some countries in Europe have learned is actually quite good? Or again, you know, those investments that I mentioned that Germany has made and Italy has not made. Why don't we have conditions about that? Not about conditions what not to spend, you know, how much not to spend, the 3% voodoo kind of target, you know, why not pi, 3.14? You know, why not make conditions across Europe on the lessons we can learn from each other and what it has been important to spend on to create that kind of solidarity, which could also present a very different story from what's happening, what will probably happen in the next 4 years in the US. But sorry, talking too much.
I don't know, have I understood right that there might be some changes in the fiscal pact, or that?
That's my hope, and I think discussion starts, but the response of Mr. Schäuble was pretty quick, and saying, okay, this is bullshit again, which came not as a surprise. He didn't use exactly that word, sorry. But was felt like that. But I think we have to start the debate, because the austerity model definitely failed, and we are now confronted with the detrimental consequences. And what I really fear is that the rise of the right-wing populists is definitely fueled by that kind of politics, and we have a question of allocation, social justice, which is now on top on the agenda of Europe, or at least it should be.
And also, I mean, the policies that are suggested by, by Mariana Mazzucato, it's the question whether they are possible within the fiscal pact, maybe. What do you, like, investments in infrastructure, investment in innovation, or do you see that it would be possible to do this within the framework?
I think there is some headroom. If you look at the Juncker Fund, for example, Juncker Fund, then it makes a lot of sense to increase it, to set up a PPP model, which could be viable. But basically, we need a more fundamental discussion, because if you look at what happened with Portugal and Spain, it was quite close, then they would have been sanctioned, which would have been really ridiculous and doesn't make sense, because they are back on the path, and they have an acceptable development. But again, that was a breach basically of the Maastricht rules. And so we really have reached the point where it makes a lot of sense to say, okay, sit down and discuss if this concept is really something which is future proof.
Yeah, absolutely. I find it, so this is very important, because the money is there when we need it, right? So if you have an earthquake in Italy, all of a sudden we relax the rules. If you have terrorism in Paris and, you know, the investments that they wanted, all of a sudden there's room, you know, to relax the rules. And so this is the point. If we start saying, if we want to take seriously this challenge of having smart investment-led growth, innovation-led growth, sustainable growth, that is going to take money. So either we abandon those hopes, so the European Commission should, you know, erase its website, basically, because Horizon 2020 is all about smart, inclusive, sustainable growth. If we want that, it will recreate, you know, it will require investment. So on the one hand, you have Renzi going to the European Commission and saying, hold on, this isn't going to work, relax the rules. But he's either just asked it for the earthquake, or because he wants to reduce tax, right? Because the deficit is G minus T, government spending minus taxation. He's wanted to reduce some tax to stimulate investment. He hasn't actually said, we have a great investment plan in Italy. You know, it's going to do this, that, the other on whether it's green or digital, et cetera. I don't hear across Europe a serious investment plan. And this is important, because we shouldn't pretend that infrastructure is an investment plan. Right? I mean, the IMF and the World Bank, after many years that we've just passed of austerity, finally said, whoops, austerity didn't work. Go build some bridges and roads, right? Infrastructure. So infrastructure in and of itself, unless it's part of sort of a plan on how to transform an economy, so green infrastructure or digital infrastructure. I hear you have, a digital plan, if it's true. I mean, I don't know. No, that was not a critique, sorry. I keep doing gaffes. If one wants to do that, then you would need, a digital infrastructure taken seriously. And in fact, this whole issue of, broadband across the entire nation being upscaled could be part of your transformation of the country. But this notion that you just have to dig some ditches and filling them up again, as Keynes said, that might in the short term create some growth, but in the long term, the long run multiplier, so the effect that public spending actually has on long run GDP is very much dependent on this directionality question. So getting that infrastructure spending or the SME support kind of really lined up in a systemic plan of how you want to transform the country is essential. And I think you're in a very good place to lead that discussion, also given that you know so much about, actual industry in my book. Yeah.
Well,
given that you read my book, no, just kidding.
The Chancellor, of course, does have some experience, some very important one, because, Austria has a very long tradition in ownership of public companies or shares of public companies, and you have been the head of the Austrian Railways. So I was wondering if you could give us an insight in the company's innovation processes. On one hand, I would just like to add some things. And also, if you were back then exposed to governmental innovation policies, what your opinion was about them, and whether this has changed now that you're in politics yourself.
Yeah, das wird jetzt eine lange Antwort. Okay, nein, also ich glaube, wenn man sozusagen sich anschaut, was die Aufgabe ist aus der österreichischen Sicht, dann ist das, was Frau Mazzucato gesagt hat, glaube ich, der ganz entscheidende Punkt. Es geht nicht darum, Löcher zu graben und sie wieder zuzuschütten. Das kann ja nicht der Ansatz sein. Aber es geht aus meiner Sicht um drei ganz wesentliche Dinge. Das erste ist, wir haben nun mal einen, das klingt aus der österreichischen Perspektive, wenn man sich die diversen Diskussionen über Eisenbahntunnels anschaut, vielleicht überraschend, aber wir haben einen Mangel an öffentlichen Investitionen. Im OECD-Schnitt liegt er bei 8% des Budgets, in Österreich sind wir bei 6%. Folgt man den OECD-Einschätzungen, verlieren wir damit wesentliche Wachstumspotenziale. Das zweite Problem, das wir haben, ist mit Sicherheit, dass wir die Potenziale in unserem Land nicht entsprechend ausnützen. Das ist der Bildungsbereich, aber vor allem auch die Frage der Frauenbeschäftigung. Wir haben einen Erwerbsanteil von Frauen, der zu gering ist und an dem muss man arbeiten. Und da hat es mit Kinderbetreuungseinrichtungen, Schulen zu tun, wieder Infrastruktur. Und wenn wir über Infrastrukturinvestments reden, dann ist es ja bewusst so gewählt, dass wir sagen, Bildungseinrichtungen, das ist ja auch das Ganztagsschulpaket von der Sonja, 750 Millionen in Infrastruktur, auch hier soll sich ja auszahlen, auch in dieser Hinsicht. Das dritte große Thema, das wir haben, ist sicherlich das Regulierungsthema, weil wir in vielen Teilen zu kompliziert, falsch reguliert sind, Diskussionen führen, die sozusagen Entscheidungen eher behindern. Also das ist auch eine Erfahrung, die ich gemacht habe und das führt mich zu der Frage, eines unserer ganz großen Probleme ist, dass wir eigentlich heute in Österreich nicht behaupten können, dass wir eine klare Forschungs- und Entwicklungs- und Innovationsstrategie haben. Sondern vieles passiert eher so iterativ, zufällig. Wir haben über 200 Institutionen, die in Österreich Forschungs- und Entwicklungsprojekte abwickeln. Das muss man sich mal vorstellen. Die sind nicht durch eine strategische Klammer unterfüttert. Das hat mit der Diversität zu tun zwischen Bund, Ländern und Gemeinden. Ist ein, wie ich meine, ganz großes Problem. Behindert Entscheidungen, kostet aber auch zu viel. Und Verwaltungsreform, wenn man so will, sollte an solchen Dingen natürlich ansetzen. Es ist aber nicht so, dass wir sozusagen ja völlig planlos sind. Wir gerade in Österreich, glaube ich, haben wir allen Anlass, echte Vorzeigemodelle vorzuführen. Und ich komme tatsächlich aus einer Welt, wo das paradigmatisch ja so funktioniert hat, weil Österreich hat die mit Abstand innovativste Bahnindustrie der Welt. Also wenn Sie sich anschauen, das wird Ihnen vielleicht nicht bewusst sein, aber Patente pro Kopf, dann hat Österreich die meisten Bahnindustriepatente auf der ganzen Welt. Wie kommt das? Weil hier ganz bewusst eine Strategie entwickelt worden ist, wo man gesagt hat, man nimmt öffentliches Geld, investiert in den Bahnsektor. Dieser Bahnsektor stellt sich zur Verfügung quasi als Heimmarkt für diese Industrie. Da stecken Firmen dahinter wie Voest, wie Siemens, Blass und Teuer, Frequentis und sie können diese Kette beliebig weiterentwickeln. Die haben auf die Basis dieses Heimmarkts und des öffentlichen Gelds ein Geschäftsmodell entwickelt, das sie mittlerweile zu der exportstärksten oder deinen exportstärksten Industriezweige Österreichs gemacht haben mit F&E-Quoten von über 9%. Und es ist heute so zum Beispiel, dass zwischen Peking und Shanghai Weichen der Voest verlegt worden sind und zwischen Moskau und St. Petersburg Schienen der Voest verlegt worden sind. Also diese Beispiele haben wir. Und wir haben auch sozusagen in weniger konventionellen Industrien, wo wir unsere Stärken haben, und Bahn ist ja industrielles Erbe Europas, da entsprechende Fortschritte gemacht. Ich war unlängst in Klagenfurt, ist wirklich lohnenswert, sich das anzusehen, ist ja nicht unbedingt einer der Plätze, wo man zuerst dran denkt, dass das irgendwie eine gute Business Location ist. Jetzt schon. Das war jetzt keine, also ich bin nicht obsessed von der FPÖ, also das war jetzt keine Anspielung. Nein, aber was haben die dort getan? Und das muss man fairerweise sagen, hat er unter dem Vorgänger Landeshauptmann bereits begonnen. Die haben einen Business Park dort entwickelt, einen Campus, wo mittlerweile 1.100 Menschen arbeiten, 64 junge Unternehmen angesiedelt sind. Der Campus ist ins Leben gerufen worden vom Infrastrukturministerium, gemeinsam mit dem Land, gemeinsam mit der Gemeinde. Es ist kein Zufall, dass der Campus genau an der Grenze zur Universität steht, weil wir dort einen permanenten Transfer von den Unis, von den Professoren, Studenten in diese Unternehmen hin erleben. Es ist so, dass dort 300 Meter davon entfernt eine internationale Schule gebaut worden ist, wieder mit öffentlichem Geld, wieder mit öffentlichen Mitteln, mit ihrem Steuergeld, dass es ermöglichen soll, dass Menschen aus dem Ausland kommen, Forscher, Geschäftsleute, die dann hier arbeiten, ihre Kinder dort versorgen können. Und vor allem ist es auch so, dass natürlich diese Unternehmen, wenn man mit denen redet, nahezu alle finanziert worden sind durch AWS, FFG, also durch öffentliche Hände, öffentliche Mittel. Und da gibt es mittlerweile ein paar tolle Erfolgsgeschichten. Bedauerlicherweise das Erfolgreichste hat mittlerweile sozusagen eine Steuerkonstruktion über Delaware produziert. Aber das ist etwas, was man vielleicht an gesonderter Stelle diskutieren muss. Aber wir haben diese Beispiele und die muss man, glaube ich, ausbauen und konsequent weiter vorantreiben. Das ist die Idee.
Back a little bit just to the public corporations. Do you think that they might be a good vehicle to stimulate innovation?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, we have the example of ÖBB, but there are a lot of others. For example, Telekom Austria is one of the major investors in startups. They have a lot of incredible efforts and very successful, and there are some others as well. And that's especially with regard to the structure of the Austrian industry, because what the Germans call a so-called Mittelstandsunternehmen is a big player here in Austria. And so therefore, I think it makes a lot of sense that public companies act in their capacity as frontrunners. Yeah.
Professor Mazzucato, what structures do you think are best suited for creating innovation, this direction, directed, targeted innovation?
So I think there's two issues maybe that's important to make clear. The first is, because I kept throwing around this word mission-oriented, it's what I mean by that is when you focus not on a list of sectors, like, you know, automotive, life sciences, financial services, but on big problems that a particular economy wants to face, which could even be as foolish as going to the moon, right? I mean, going to the moon created lots of different activity across many different sectors. It wasn't a sectoral approach. Or Germany's Energiewende policy, which has required lots of different sectors in Germany to change what they're doing, again, both in terms of production and distribution. So by having a problem-specific sort of strategy, this transformational policy, the more it's focused on big problems, but also then supporting your sectors, you know, to get involved in that transformation. Within those sectors, there's many companies, not all of which can be supported. So I personally don't believe that we should focus on size. There's this kind of myth about the SMEs. Most SMEs, to be honest, are SMEs because they're not very good. they're small companies because they haven't grown. Some SMEs have a potential to grow and really need public support. In order to scale up. And that kind of scaling up of small companies whether it's through procurement policies, but especially through developing an ecosystem of innovation that really supports them, for example, through the use of patient finance, because this kind of 3 to 5 year cycle that venture capitalists have, it's all exit driven. They want the exit to occur in 3 to 5 years through an IPO or a buyout. That's okay to get you a gadget, but it doesn't get you real big transformations as we witnessed with biotech, nanotech, et cetera. And I don't think there's one recipe. In fact, what's interesting when we look around the world is there's different types of organizational forms. For example, many countries don't have public banks. But the ones that do, what kind of public bank? So the public bank in Italy, Cassa Depositi e Prestiti, to be honest, is pretty, I don't know, it doesn't have a very important role. It's not very strategic. It sees itself as mainly just kind of infrastructure kind of investments, leveraging up some things that companies are already doing. It's not transformational. Other types of public banks, whether we look at China or Germany or in some other countries, have had a very specific kind of a form that they've taken, also in terms of where the money comes from. That matters. In Italy, it's through postal bonds, which by definition are going to be quite short term. Then there's other forms. By the way, Germany kind of cheats with this because it was set up through the Marshall Plan. The KfW, their public bank, so they aren't actually accused of anti-competition policy because of that, whereas sometimes these public banks are accused of being anti-competitive because they're supplying so much, you know, public finance to particular companies. But I think the big issue should be how to, and I mentioned this in the beginning, have a plan, have a mission, but also retain diversity within it. You don't, if you have a green policy, put all your eggs into the offshore wind basket, right? You need to retain that diversity, which, you know, keeps open different possibilities. And in many countries, actually civil society movements, just think of the green movement, how important it has been, can actually help steer not just the portfolios, but how we think about directionality within some of these missions. And I think it is important to engage civil society as best as one can, which doesn't mean you have a referendum, God forbid, after the one we just had, on, you know, every decision government has to make. But engagement is important. You can't, you know, force big changes to occur. But I think we definitely need new forms of public-private partnerships. And I think the examples you gave are specific types of public-private partnerships that worked. We've had other types of public-private partnerships, for example, the PFI schemes in the healthcare area of the UK, which have not worked very well at all. And one of the reasons they didn't work is that one of the things I personally think the public of the public-private partnership should do is also define what it is we're even trying to produce. So to have a measure for public value, to make sure that this public money even merits, you know, the taxpayer contribution in terms of creating something that's good for society. So if instead the public money is seen to just de-risk the private side, and the private side defines what kind of hospitals, what kind of healthcare, what we mean by green, that's a problematic relationship. So measures of public value, I think, are very important. And surprise, surprise, in economics, we don't have the word public value. We have it in philosophy. There's social value and public value. We have the notion of the public good in economics, but it's very, very narrow. It doesn't actually get us that full breadth of, you know, the investments that we need, and it doesn't necessarily help us define that sort of more inclusive policy generation process that, of course, has to be there if public investment is going to be. So what kind of transport? What does it mean for citizenry to have a good experience in the transport system? Or when we talk about health care, the care part, care, what do we mean by care? A caring society. That discussion about a caring society should also help define a public-private partnership in health.
So, okay, so let's talk about public-private partnerships maybe a little bit more. Yeah.
Or no? No?
You mean the public-private partnerships or in general?
Oh, in general. Don't all these people want to ask us questions? No?
Well, a little bit later maybe, okay. I think. Yeah. We still have a lot of questions that I will not be able to ask anyway, but a few I have to ask, I'm afraid.
Okay.
But no, but like this we heard that the government has to take a lot of risks in order to support innovation, but it should also take a share of the reward. This is easier said than, I don't know, probably implemented. I don't know, and obviously you support this idea.
Yeah, basically I do, but honestly speaking, being an Austrian, we have to confess that that wasn't always a big success story, reaching back to the 80s, for example. But what we are talking now is that it's a complete change in patterns and economic activities, and it's so accelerated, and the pace is much more speedy than it was before. And that's the reason why I believe we have to look at different answers to the challenges we have today. For example, you can't compare the shareholding of the Republic of Austria in the early 80s with what is required in the, with respect to the startups. And if you would like to be an active entrepreneurial state, you have to have a clear concept and idea about in which direction markets are heading, and at least intending to support. And I think it makes a lot of sense to finance such corporates, plus again then remaining at least for a short period or a certain period as a shareholder there as well. But it's not a good concept to come back to a big state-owned economy. That's not what we're intending to, of course.
I completely agree. This is not about going back to some sort of old-fashioned or even just past way of nationalizing industry. It's about, as I said, changing the conversation of where wealth comes from. So just think of patents, right? Patents are, for some reason, called intellectual property rights. And the word right makes you think that the company has the right to have the patent, but they're actually contracts. And one way to get back this public reward for the innovation is actually to make sure that we're shaping and governing those contracts properly. So one of the big problems, again, in modern day capitalism is that what is being patented is very problematic. We're patenting increasingly upstream. We're patenting the tools for research. Right? That is not a good return on investment for the public, because the patent is a contract that gives the firm 20 years of monopoly profits. That's not bad. That's going to incentivize their innovation. Great, because otherwise, if you had free flow, free information, there wouldn't be an incentive to do something if someone can just copy you. But what the government gets from it, right? It's a contract, two parties. Both get something, is that that patent is codified, it's written down, so when the patent is up, it helps diffusion of the innovation across the whole economy, etc. But if in the meantime, what has been patented are the tools for research, so the hammer, you've also really blocked innovation from occurring in those 20 years around that area. They are increasingly wide, these patents. So we're allowing patents, instead of being narrow and weak — weak means easily licensable, narrow means just patenting what you've actually done — we've permitted, and this is because, you know, we've allowed it in sort of patent-friendly courts, to be too wide. So just like cats that pee to prevent other cats from coming near them, not to stake out their territory, we are sort of blocking innovation. And this is the big irony, that in a world of big data and open innovation, we're actually going back to the Middle Ages in terms of secrecy by allowing this particular type of patenting to happen. So this is not about against patents, but what we've allowed them to do. And we should have that public return kind of mentality in terms of how we shape them. But similarly, I was told that in your country, you still don't have open, you know, data access. There still is quite a bit of secrecy in terms of this 1925 Act. I can't remember the name. You know, that could be, for example, one way that you try to steer your digital agenda to be more inclusive by actually, you know, making it more transparent in terms of data, which doesn't mean that there's no conditions attached, but it just means that it's some of these, you know, conditionalities around investment, which can actually be approaching the social return aspect. It's not just about equity. The equity example, by the way, I gave is simply, realistically, if we're going to have government investing in particular companies like Tesla, which got $465 million as a guaranteed loan, given that usually for every successful investment, there's lots of failures, we either go back to the taxation rate that we had when NASA was founded, under a Republican military president, Eisenhower, the top marginal rate was 91%. Surprise, Republican president, 91% top marginal taxation rate. Or in some cases, like that Tesla investment, which also in the same portfolio generated many failures, why not allow some temporary you know, access to equity of the public funds that invested. So you're not nationalizing Tesla, but you retain some equity in those shares to cover the inevitable cylindras that also occur within that portfolio. Countries like Israel do that. You know, there's been Finnish investment funds which have done it. It's not impossible. We have to manage it properly, but we know it's doable.
Yeah, I don't know if you could reply shortly. Otherwise, I would actually go to maybe a final round of questions mm-hmm. that are about pluralism and then open the floor to the audience so that the audience can also ask them. We have Twitter, of course, Twitter. I thought that because we do it a bit earlier, we can, besides that, we have one micro. We can. Let's see. Okay. The last round of questions was going to be about pluralism, because we as the Society for Pluralism in Economics, we find that many schools of thought, many economic schools of thought, don't find the adequate attention and access at universities nowadays. And Mariana, your work clearly does not fit the mainstream. You often refer to neo-Schumpeterianism mm-hmm. and evolutionary economics, which is why we would like to ask you about your personal experiences in your career as a heterodox non-standard economist.
Okay, so I mean, I was actually studying history in my undergraduate degree at Tufts, and I became very interested in what was happening in Boston, which is where the university was, in terms of labor unions. And so I started working with two particular labor unions, and I realized the whole dimension of technological change being so important to how workers in those particular environments were experiencing modern, if you want, technological changes. And I realized that the little economics I had studied in university really couldn't deal with technological change at all. And I was advised by one of my supervisors to go study Marx, who, it wasn't just Marx. He said, you should look at the work of Marx and Schumpeter, who actually put innovation at the center of their way that they thought about capitalism. And in fact, if you read, so that got me interested, and I ended up going to the New School for Social Research in New York, which is well known for being one of the few places in the world that teaches different types of thinking in economics, from post-Keynesian, neo-Ricardian, Marxian, neoclassical, which is the mainstream approach, seriously, not just as history of thought. Because on the one hand, there's the problem that we don't do enough history of thought, but when we do, it's just history. It's not taught as potential different ways to do analysis in economics. But just quickly, what was interesting in Marx, and Schumpeter basically copied Marx, Schumpeter, most of the interesting things he said on innovation were already in Marx. What Marx said was, what actually differentiates capitalism from feudalism, which was 500 years of inertia, nothing happening, was innovation. And firms actually are constantly competing for market share. And they do so through innovation, and then he started to look at the distributional consequences of innovation and all sorts of other things. But Schumpeter picks that up in a very important way. He says, hold on, how can it be that in order to talk about firms competing through innovation in economics, we have to resort to imperfect competition, theories of imperfect competition? We actually don't have a proper theory of competition at the heart of economic analysis that allows us to talk about innovation. And I think one of the roles of this kind of rethinking economics and pluralist economics movements, more than thinking up new ideas in economics, has been really to rediscover some really important points in people like Marx and Schumpeter and Minsky and Keynes, but also to bring it, you know, to the modern era. So exactly as you were saying, that some old solutions are no longer useful necessarily today, in the same way maybe how these thinkers were interpreted in the past is different from today. But, you know, look at all the QE money that was used, you know, money creation that was used, which just ended up in the banks. There's lots of really interesting insights in Minsky that helps to explain that in terms of the financial instability of capitalism, and again, finance sort of seeking other types of speculative of returns rather than being fueled into the real economy. But one of the big questions today in Europe is if we're going to be not just creating money through QE, through the ECB, but also perhaps directing it through, for example, you know, the EIB loans being working alongside the ECB bonds, and different people have written different things about this, that whole issue of directing money creation in particular ways to, you know, actually fuel real growth in the economy versus, again, this financialized form of growth really requires us going back to the works of Keynes and Minsky and not just thinking things up, you know, on a Monday and then realizing that we've just created another problem.
Don't ask me to respond now. but just one remark, perhaps which fits to what you have explained right now about economic theory and discussions in Austria. What I've learned is that I had the opportunity to explain what we believe makes sense in economics policy in an essay which was published in the FAZ, German newspaper. And was quite funny because the essay had 24,000 signs. Took me a while to type it. And the answer I received from our government partner was given again via Twitter, which is 140 signs, 24,140, which explains a little bit how serious these economic debates are here in this country. And what I've learned from that experience, because there was a lot of, not so much support in public, and especially not in the mainstream media and newspapers, honestly speaking. But what I've learned from that is never fix a problem of which people are not aware that it exists. Biggest mistake for a politician, better forget it. And even it's going to kill you next week, but so first people have to be aware, then discuss, and so that's the reason why I appreciate so much to have a public debate about the alternatives.
Yeah, but there is one question that I also would like to direct towards you. We're so pleased to have Mariana Mazzucato here because she's one of the economists, of the heterodox economists who has made it into the mainstream. Not all the other heterodox economists are that successful, and of course the university science and teaching is free. You shouldn't interfere in it, but there are maybe some ways, like the design of calls for funding for research, or I don't know, the definition of evaluation criteria for universities, where you might be able to support such alternative approaches that can bring new ideas into the problems that we have for solutions.
Which I basically would support, but as you know, the relation between the government and the university is based on a very transparent contract, and the budget is given to the universities, and then it's up to Mrs. Hanna-Bjerke to decide with her colleagues how the money is going to be allocated. And sorry for abstaining to answer your question, but that's all I have to say.
Okay.
Oh, well.
Up to her.
Yeah.
I'm in charge of the country, which doesn't mean I can decide everything here.
Yeah.
For good reasons, by the way.
Yeah. I mean, I think there are different stakeholders that should join the discussion on how teaching and science in economics is being done. So, let's just have a discussion.
Concrete thing you can do, because in Holland this happened. They had a whole process of valorization where both the industries but also the researchers had to prove their economic value. And then if you looked at exactly how it was done, it was very, very limited. So actually, if these, you know, big debates about what kind of economy we want can also help redefine what we mean by valorization, both in terms of universities when they have to, you know, show the impact that they've had, but also when you define which industries you want to be, you know, sort of supporting around these big missions, to always remember that the humanities and the social sciences have always been in the history of progress, just as important in many ways as the natural sciences, that actually needs to be nurtured. It's not obvious. It's easy to fall back and think it's just STEM subjects. But, you know, critical thinking in economics and sociology and history and poetry is important. By the way, Apple has plenty of poets and musicians, you know, and not just engineers. And a society itself also needs the social scientists to be just as well treated as the, you know, physicists and the engineers. And that, it's nice when it comes top down.
Okay. Yeah. So I would like to invite
sorry for interrupting you. I think one aspect is really, really important, and it doesn't make sense to streamline universities and science to the market requirements. And if you ask me, I appreciate always that in 10 years we will have funded studies who are able to explain us what the meaning of the blaue Kornblume is, yeah, for example. I don't know the word in English, Kornblume.
No, it's a flower that the right-wing people use. Yeah, but Stefan, could we hear something from the audience?
There were so many great questions, 30, 40 questions which are online, and I'm obviously not going to ask them all to you because this is getting too late, maybe, to all of us, but it's... If anyone's interested, there's a really great debate going on. I want to ask you two questions now, and then you can decide on what you want to do with them, maybe. And I'll come to a third and last and final question afterwards. And the first two questions were, the first one was, we're talking about maybe Austria here, and what is your suggestion for smaller countries? Because you're using examples many times of... the United States, where public investments and their capabilities are much, much larger. So what does it mean for a smaller country like Austria? And I stop your idea. And the second question is maybe more difficult to answer, but how can today's increasing waves of forced migration contribute to the entrepreneurial state? And what is the connection that might be there? Is there any connection at all? And this question is obviously addressed to both of you. So thank you. These were the first two.
Will last until 9 o'clock. And I don't know about the organizational terms of your time afterwards. Do we have some time to sign books?
Yeah.
Okay, and there will be a short book signing after the event. So just that you know. Mm-hmm.
Right. So, no, the only reason I focus on the U.S. is not because it's more important, but unfortunately, so many countries continue to come up with kind of ridiculous innovation policies because they think they understood what happened in Silicon Valley. So in the U.K., we have Tech City, which otherwise known as Silicon Roundabout. And I can tell you they didn't learn the lessons that I talked about. So then... You know, it's focused on funds of funds and getting the venture capital community interested in a particular part of London, and all sorts of interesting things happen. But, you know, the VCs in Silicon Valley came in 30 years after massive public investments. And so we need to be very careful when we talk about wanting to create something new to make sure we understand that full surfing of the wave and think of new ways potentially to do that in a particular area. Denmark is a small country, right, that one might potentially compare to Austria. And I always use Denmark as an interesting example because not only did they make the choice to become, you know, to transform the country in this green direction, not only did they do it in a mission-oriented way, which allowed lots of different sectors to interact with this green mission, but by doing it, I would say, with quite a bit of dynamism and not just focusing on particular sectors, they also created real synergies between manufacturing and services. And that whole issue of manufacturing versus services as potentially being trade-offs really didn't happen there. And they've become the number one provider of high-tech services to China's green economy. And China spending $1.7 trillion with 12 zeros on green. So how cool to be their, you know, provider of high-tech services for China's green transformation, and that would have never happened had Denmark seen its green policies just as fixing market failures, some basic research in renewable energy, some, you know, policies here and there for SMEs interested to engage in that, some carbon taxes. It really required this kind of transformational, mission-oriented innovation policy across the whole economy, and there's very interesting lessons there to learn. Same kinds of, you know, green visions in some countries, which again just produce very patchy policies, have very little effect. And actually giving importance to these differences and looking at the different instruments, different types of organizations, but especially this, what I'm calling mission orientation, which is problem specific more than sector specific, and learning from that, I think is very important. And there's small countries like Denmark give us huge lessons to learn.
Question to both of you, the one on the forced migration and the connection to the entrepreneurial state.
Could I switch back to the easier one? No. Migration, I think we have totally different demographic patterns in Europe, and it makes a big difference if you look at this phenomenon from a German perspective or from an Austrian one. But there are Just 2 points. First one is when I was the CEO of ÖBB, we were very proud about our vocational training, and we hired some of the young ladies and boys becoming apprentices in ÖBB, and I was always so impressed how fast they have learned the language and how hungry for success and being educated they were. So there are a lot of good role models which are demonstrating that they are enriching our society and our economy. On the other hand, for sure, it's to some extent, it's a certain financial burden. So Austria is investing 2 billion euros next year for integration, education, and supply of food and clothes and so on, which is the flip side of the coin. But for me, it's not so much a matter of looking at this from an economic angle. It's something which we are obliged to do, because that's part of our understanding of human rights and how to treat minorities.
Maybe you want to elude us in where you could see a possible connection between these things, maybe as a...
With immigration?
Yeah, immigration, yeah, I mean, forced migration, and maybe it's one of the problems you were talking about.
I mean,
so
to
as problems which can be tackled.
Yeah, I mean, just in terms of the welcoming of diverse populations, there's no example better than entrepreneurship. Again, Silicon Valley has very few, you know, WASPs. They're from all over the world leading these companies. And what we know also, even in studies that people have done on particular companies that have been run by, you know, sort of family-run companies that hire and, you know, people that are just related to the family, we know also that they're less efficient, less productive. So if you broaden that out to the country for just hiring and just working with each other in a small, narrowly defined population, over time, we also become less productive. We have a lower pool of great resources to be choosing from. However, obviously, this is not, you know, we can't just be naive. We need to be creating opportunities and investing in the capacity building of the people. It's not enough just to say, okay, world, come, so we can choose you to run our great companies, and that's a better, you know, diverse portfolio of people than a very narrow one. We need to be investing in that capacity. People, like plants, need to be watered. And if we don't dedicate the resources not just to education, but also to sensitivity, you know, of the population to this diversity, it's not going to work. And again, that does come back to the whole issue of austerity. These investments cost money. And I think it's we need to prioritize this opportunity creation and investment in people, not just our own people, but creating our own economies that can also absorb the people who come. It's not going to happen on its own. But coming back to the issue of financialization, when we look at the investments, at least across many OECD countries, that have gone to creating skills in the workplace, because skills are endogenous to the investment function itself, there's a problem there. And that isn't unrelated to immigration, because again, the people who are coming need to be invested in, not just by government training programs, but when they're hired, they shouldn't just be hired for 2 or 3 months and then spat out later when they're no longer needed. Getting back into an idea that the workplace itself doesn't have to be a lifelong career, but it should, over time, in the different companies that one works for, different organizations, be a lifelong process of receiving this investment in terms of human capital formation requires real thinking, and lining that up with our immigration policies, I think, you know, is important. So we don't just see immigration as this isolated problem, but as, you know, nurturing new types of human capital.
Thank you. The last question is, I think then that might be enough for us. And I know that's like a very huge topic I'm opening up right now, but not to, but just to mention it. And the one thing is financial and fiscal limitations. So do they apply? What is the reason to them maybe that they don't apply? Fiscal limitations. And the other part would be ecological limitations to growth. I know it's both like very huge debates and huge topics I'm opening with that, but I would like to, yeah, that you might give an answer to this as well, or where you see, where you stand on this. Both of you, whoever wants to.
Yeah, just want to touch one of the details you mentioned. If we look at today's status of economy, then it's crystal clear that regaining growth is number one priority. And if you look at former times, you can see that economic growth got a tremendous boost from the invention of the automobile, railways before computer, internet, and so on. And if you look at our opportunities and the challenges of our days, then I think there is one thing which could really trigger additional growth, and which is adapting our economy to climate change. And so I believe it's a big chance, big opportunity, and so even more, it's such a sad story that Mr. Trump will withdraw from the Paris Agreement.
Could you maybe just a quick comment on this topic? Or no?
Okay. Yeah, I mean, yeah, in terms of the limits to growth, I mean, personally, I find, but you know, people think differently on this, that the problem is not do we want to grow or not. It's, again, what kind of growth? So this issue of sustainable growth should actually be very explicitly engaging us all, the economists, the policymakers, and again, civil society and businesses, which what do we mean by sustainable growth? But it's not about growing or not. If we don't grow, there's going to be lots of unemployment. But what kind of growth and what forms of employment are really the big questions. Now, anyway, on the Paris climate agreements, I would have lots to say, but I think that brings us too far away. But on the finance issue, I mean, you know, money, and this is again back to Keynes and Minsky and others, you know, money is basically created through the debt creation, you know, mechanism, right? And in that sense, it's endogenous. There's this whole approach to, you know, endogenous money creation. Some people call it modern monetary theory. But there's the big point there is that, you know, obviously, within Europe right now, it's very difficult because we don't, well, it's not difficult, it's different than in a country like the US, which has its own central bank. We have central banks in each country, but actually it's only through the ECB that that money creation process can actually happen. But first, there's this issue of, you know, directionality. You don't just create money and think it's going to, you know, create all this growth. What we see in both the micro and the macro side is one, which is what I just said, which is if you actually create, you know, the trillions of euros that were created without creating the opportunities for growth, they just end up in the banks. And two, at the micro level, you can reduce, you can increase profits of companies by reducing, say, taxes, and that won't necessarily increase their investments unless there's opportunities for investment. So the real issue about, you know, finance is how can we actually create the opportunities for investment and then link that up with the, if you want, different ways in which money can be created so that the finance is actually fueling growth in the real economy. And that's not what we've experienced recently. And I really think that by focusing policy on opportunity creation, that makes us rethink also the role of finance.
Thanks. Well, because you're...
Yeah, what happened? What did I say?
Because the other panelist had to step out for a second.
I'm not sure. Is he coming back? Oh yeah.
Okay.
Does someone? No. Was this a security? A security issue? Oh,
I don't know.
Some if not, I would have another question, but it's. Yeah. Now? Yes? No? Maybe?
Yeah, but actually, I think that we're not gonna wait because I don't know what happened. Unless you have a lot of time, but yeah. Let me announce that after a short break, Professor Mazzucato will be signing books out.
Just for 15 minutes, we said.
Yeah,
that.
Yeah. For 15 minutes. Yeah. So if you want it, you have to be real quick and stand in line. I would like to thank, of course, Professor Mazzucato and the Chancellor that they were here. And, of course, okay, maybe he heard it, yeah. And of course, I want to thank all the people who have been involved in the organization of this event. It's incredible how much organization a two-hour event needs, yeah.
So sorry, it was a little bit unconventional, but I thought your answer is going to be a little bit longer.
Meanwhile, we have almost closed the event, but it's nice that you came back because now we can get all together and say goodbye and thank you for the whole evening. Yeah, thanks
a lot.
The time.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
So we wanted to do a proper photograph. Okay, we could.